I signed up to change the world, Saylor likes to say. He compares himself to Thomas Edison, Henry Ford, Andrew Carnegie, and John D. Rockefeller. The way we've played this business and the way we have played the game at MicroStrategy is unwilling to hedge ever. Saylor says he will not sell his firm to a larger competitor, no matter what the offer. I can't hedge against the probability of future problems. I'm going to go to extremes. I have $50,000 in the bank, $7 to $8 million in the company. Either we're going to make it big or lose it all. I'd rather lose $100 million and take my shot at greatness than sell out and become a millionaire. That is a quote from my notes on early Michael Saylor. Michael Saylor in the 80s and 90s. What I'm going to share with you today, I'm calling it the origin story of Michael Saylor, using some articles from the 90s that I could find on the internet and a great interview with Charlie Rose from 2000. Here it is, the origin story of Michael Saylor. My name is Andy Flattery, and I'm the owner of Simple Wealth Planning, a registered investment advisor. All opinions expressed by me and my guests are solely our own opinions and do not reflect the opinions of Simple Wealth Planning. This podcast is for informational and entertainment purposes only and should not be relied upon as investment, tax, or legal advice. Clients of Simple Wealth Planning may maintain positions in Bitcoin and the securities discussed in this podcast. And full disclosure, today we're going to be talking about Michael Saylor, the founder and chairman of MicroStrategy. I have been a shareholder of his company, ticker symbol MSTR, since May of 2022 and started buying the shares at $167 a share.
Michael Saylor is president and CEO of MicroStrategy. He founded the startup in 1989 at the age of 24. Since then, the company's focus has evolved from consulting to software to e-business. Today, it is best known for helping large companies sift through their vast databases for valuable analysis and information. It has doubled in size every year and grown into a multi-million dollar company. From the beginning, it has been driven by the vision of its leader, whose mission has been nothing less than to purge ignorance from the planet. Having said that, I am pleased to have him on this program.
That is Charlie Rose introducing Michael Saylor in the year 2000. Back when Saylor was still very much sort of a tech darling, I suppose you could say, in the media, part of the dot-com boom of the 1990s. And decades before he would become the most prominent voice in the Bitcoin space in corporate America. But what I want to understand today is the origin story of Michael Saylor. So where did he come from? What were his upbringings? Who was he in the 80s and the 90s? So I'll leave all the links for the pieces that I used for the notes in the show notes. So you can read this for yourself. But what I found is several articles, pieces on Saylor back when he was, I would say, correct me if I'm wrong, I wasn't around back then paying attention, but it seems to me that he was kind of viewed in the same class as like your Larry Ellisons and your Steve Jobs and maybe even your Jeff Bezoses, if you will, back when these pieces were written. Going back to the beginning, Michael Saylor was born in Lincoln, Nebraska. So we're going to claim him as a Midwestern guy, as one who lives in the Midwest. His father was in the Air Force. So it sounded like they spent some time when he was younger on military bases, but largely he was raised in Fairborn, Ohio. They lived in a government issue, aluminum sided duplex, shopped at a commissary, rode the bus, stuck to a $20 a month recreation budget.
When I was 3 years old, my first memory was standing in a room, and it was like a Sunday afternoon after my parents went to church. And the Sunday afternoon ritual was people come over to the house for a potluck supper, and they all bring a dish. And so I was 3 years old, and I'm standing there in the foyer, and I know that the kids are supposed to go in the backyard. The adults with the food are supposed to drop it on the, you know, in the dining room on the left. And the adults without the food are supposed to go to the living room on the right. And so I'm standing there directing traffic and people come in and I'm pointing them toward the left, the right, or telling the kids to go in the back. And then there are some adults that are ignoring me. And all I can think is, what's wrong with these people? Why don't they know that I'm in charge here? I know what's going on.
Family was vital to his own development. So Saylor frequently mentions his mother, Phyllis Ann Saylor, who used to work days and nights as a department store clerk to help support the family. On Sunday morning, she would wake up at 5:30 a.m. to help her son deliver newspapers. And then Saylor was quoted saying, quote, "If your parents tell you you will do great things, you will do great things. I was lucky enough not to come out of high school with a lot of angst. It helps in this process not to lack confidence," end quote. What strikes me about this is how normal that is. And Saylor seems to be from a kind of an all-American background. And I don't mean that as like some sort of rags to riches story. As we've talked about on this podcast a lot, you know, clearly legacy is something that matters, and it doesn't have to be monetary legacy. In fact, the best sort of inheritance that you can receive is usually not money. And it sounds like that is what Saylor has received. Although he was not from money, the seeds were certainly planted with his family. "My father taught me character," Saylor says. "My mother taught me charisma. His dad is the one who told him he had to do things. His mother told him he could do anything he wanted because he was brilliant. In seventh grade, he was named Paperboy of the Year. His mother pulled him aside and whispered in his ear, 'You're going to grow up and do something great for society because you've got lots of gifts and you're very smart. So make sure you use all of them well.'" A couple things here. Not to compare myself to Michael Saylor, but my brothers and I were all paper boys. We think fondly. We have a lot of laughs about that period of our lives. It's kind of sad that I don't know if that job really exists anymore, or what the kind of 2024 example is of paper delivery as a 12-year-old at 5:30 in the morning. "My father was the typical disciplined military sergeant. If you're going to do something, do it right. The kind of guy that was absolutely 100% straight. I can't remember a single time in my life where my father ever said an untruth or tried to slide by with half an effort on anybody or with anything," which is kind of interesting, you know, because you don't realize how unique that is until you grow up. And then you realize that people are always like sliding by a negotiation or something, but my father never cut a corner ever. And so I think for starters here, I just want to say that it's refreshing to hear someone speak well of their father. I saw this thing on Twitter recently. I think it was from Charles Colomb, the historian. He said something to the effect of, "Every boy should think of their father as the greatest man who ever lived." And I mean, how countercultural is that? You don't hear a lot of people praising their fathers in that way. Another thing to mention about Saylor's childhood was that he was a voracious reader. He used his money to buy comic books, and he said, In one summer, I must have read 100 books, just lots of books. His mother knew something was up when she took him to the pediatrician around that time, and the discussion between her second grader and the doctor turned to the Isaac Asimov novel they were both reading. And he says that he had read hundreds of books by the sixth grade. He had a book with him all the time, reading after school and on weekends. "I became a science fiction freak," he said. He took as his intellectual mentor Robert Heinlein, Kansas City native, by the way, the sci-fi author best known for Stranger in a Strange Land. Saylor, who says he had read all of Heinlein's books twice by the time he was 18, scoffs at the mainstream work. His favorite was "Have Spacesuit, Will Travel," wherein a high school senior wins a spacesuit and gets hauled off to Pluto in an alien ship, then to the spiral arm of the galaxy where he saves the human race from a bug-eyed monster. Then he returns to Earth and gets a full scholarship to MIT. Quote, "So I stuck in my mind that really cool people go to MIT to build spaceships." With regards to reading, Saylor would later say that the lessons are of these kind of pulp novels. that people are capable of accomplishing great things if they set their mind to it, and that we should not allow ourselves to be hijacked by a small goal or a pedestrian thought. One of the themes that we've brought up on this podcast before is like the celebration of the boys' Pulp Fiction, or maybe just Pulp Fiction in general. Maybe it doesn't even have to be for boys. Certainly Saylor wasn't reading maybe some of the boy books, but yeah, for me, it was like Tom Swift, the Hardy Boys, the Three Investigators series. I think these are great. Yeah. If you can get boys into some of the aspirational Pulp Fiction to get them dreaming, and certainly to get them reading. It's cliche to say just get kids to read. You know, the response to that should always be, well, read what? But I think it's okay if it's like Pulp Fiction, some of this great science fiction, or even some of the boy books. All good stuff there by Saylor. Another theme from his childhood was actually music. So he's a guitar player. He loves to sing. He sang in the choir of a Southern Baptist church and in school and in pickup rock and roll bands. He learned to play the guitar when he was 17 because he didn't get a role in The Sound of Music at his high school, which I think is hilarious. The orchestra director said he needed someone who could play both trombone and guitar. Saylor already played trombone and taught himself guitar in 6 weeks. And apparently back in the 90s, he was inviting friends over for karaoke. And if I ever have a chance in my life to go to a Michael Saylor karaoke night, that would be a bucket list checked right there. Saylor played in school bands and marching bands and jazz groups. He listened to Van Halen and Rush and Police and the Styx, Pink Floyd and Genesis. He was known for imitating John Travolta at dances and asking cute seniors to dance when he was a nerdy freshman. I'm not sure he ever got a date with one of them, a friend said. Saylor was a valedictorian at Fairborn High and was voted most likely to succeed. He always read more than the rest of us, the friend said. He was always putting things in the context of the Greeks and the Romans, which is totally hilarious. If you listen to Bitcoin podcasts, he's doing that constantly. Listen to the Saylor series with Robert Breedlove, and there's hours and hours of talk on the Greeks and the Romans. So it's so funny that he's been doing that since a teenager. Okay, so that brings us to MIT. If you think about his sort of science fiction background, it seems to me that he really did think he was going to be one that would be launching rockets. He was a tech optimist in the same way that you might say like an Elon Musk is today. And so at MIT, he studied aeronautical engineering and the history of science. The aeronautical degree taught him basic engineering and made him want to fly jet planes. The history of science became his true love and prepared him to change the world. That's in his own words. He joined the Air Force Federal Reserve Training Corps to help pay for college and was selected to the Corps' prestigious jet pilot program. I loved it. That was my life. This was the time of Tom Cruise and Top Gun. And the best thing you could do in life was to be a jet pilot in the military. You were built up to be the king among kings, Saylor said.
Do you think your name's going to be on that plaque?
Yes, sir.
That's pretty arrogant, considering the company you're in.
Yes, sir.
I like that in the pilot.
Saylor was a strong-willed, politically conservative debater who was a devotee of George Will, which isn't a name you hear a whole lot anymore these days. His senior thesis was on a theoretical model of issues in political theory having to do with the classic city or nation state of Plato. One of the things that strikes me about all these various interests of Saylor, even now, but also certainly throughout his life, was kind of the Charlie Munger latticework thinking idea, where you need to be well-read in many different disciplines. Certainly, you know, Munger as the investor is talking about that being well-read is an advantage. Some have even called investing the last liberal art, where if you're able to sort of think laterally, think in many different disciplines, it's a way to sort of remove yourself from the silos that everyone else lives in their different fields today. No one is a lateral thinker anymore. No one has a real liberal arts background anymore. So the foreshadowing here is Saylor is not going to be sort of a one-dimensional managerial class play by the book CEO. He is going to be able to pivot many times throughout his career because of the sort of vast array of knowledge he has, like in all these different fields. And he's gonna do things sort of by his own book because he thinks of himself as sort of a great man in history. Okay, so a routine physical exam crushed Saylor's dream of a career as a pilot. During the physical, the doctors detected a benign heart murmur. The military grounded him, and when defense cutbacks set him to the reserves rather than active duty, Saylor found himself with no job, no plans, just 2 months before graduation. He found a job consulting with a software integration company focusing on computer simulation modeling, which was his college minor. And he lasted just more than a year with a startup. And so he was out on the New York streets at the age of 23. He considered himself a failure, by the way, at 23. He said, this was kind of embarrassing. I was voted most likely to succeed. I was the valedictorian of my high school. I couldn't go home. I was $5,000 in debt living in Manhattan. I was a wreck. But Saylor's luck soon changed. He had one business card in his pocket, that of a DuPont executive and former client. After hearing Saylor's story, this DuPont executive brought him to DuPont. Saylor worked there as an internal consultant developing computer simulations that would help DuPont plan for the future in its key markets. So one of the things we've talked about on this podcast before is, the ethos of like tinkering or greatness without goals. You know, the grand plan is not always going to be a straight line up. And so sometimes, you know, to achieve great things in life, it takes small stepping stones, and the plan is not always apparent right away. Anytime someone has had success, they can look back and the path in retrospect may have been clear, but often it's very much a winding path of achieving small goals, attaining skills, and certainly jumping on opportunity when it presents itself, and not always in the way that you think it's going to present itself.
And after about 18 months of doing that at the DuPont Corporation, I realized that I wasn't going to be CEO of DuPont anytime soon, and they really wanted me to just keep working while they spent the money, and I decided maybe I should go back to school or start a company, those being the two things you do when you're 24 and you're disenchanted with your current career path. So I went to DuPont. I said, I quit. I'm starting a company. I will build your global multi-user networked war game if you want me to. As a contractor, please give me money.
Okay, so now we're finally getting into the origins of MicroStrategy. While he's at DuPont, he is apparently working on some sort of early version of business analytics. And there's several stories where it talks about how he predicted a 1990 recession in many of DuPont's markets after doing computer simulations. Saylor said, I basically got an education in software on DuPont's money because they were too stubborn to admit that a recession was coming. Eventually, Saylor's software acumen so impressed DuPont executives that they hired him as an independent contractor, which basically was the seeds of MicroStrategy.
They gave me a $250,000 contract. I said, I need $100,000 in cash up front. And they said, well, we never give 24-year-old kids $100,000 in cash because you might waste it or skip off to Brazil or something. And I used this one negotiating strategy. It only works once in your life, but it worked for me. I looked at them and I said, you have to give me the $100,000 because I have no money. So like holding your breath until they give in. And they looked at that and they had to agree I did have no money. And so they gave me the $100,000 and then they gave me free office space and computer equipment and incubated the business. Then they gave me four more contracts and MicroStrategy was born.
And so again, he's talking about the DuPont Corporation here, the company that he was working for as an employee and then basically a contractor, was essentially the venture capitalist, if you will, of MicroStrategy. They initially launched in 1989 as a consulting and services firm. They introduced their first software product in 1991. A year after that, the company stumbled into a $10 million contract with McDonald's. They agreed to build applications that would help the fast food restaurant chain analyze the effectiveness of its promotional campaigns. And so that is the origin story of MicroStrategy, started, by the way, when Saylor was 24 years old. He had two co-founders, Sanju Bansal and Thomas Spar. Saylor has been the largest shareholder throughout the company's existence, and he has always controlled the most amount of voting shares. I think even still today, he has control of over 50% of the voting shares, which is important. It's basically allowed him to maintain control of this publicly traded company throughout all this time, which is extremely unusual. But I get ahead of myself. We're going to get to that. Let's talk a little bit more about what MicroStrategy was doing in the 90s. Saylor, throughout his career, he always has these sort of big ideas, these sort of big grand visions for how he wants to change the world or how he wants to impact the world. One of the ideas he was talking about in the 90s was nobody has really grasped yet the great wealth that can be made by selling data over the web. I think this was 1996, by the way. That sounds so prescient now, of course, and a little Orwellian, and we're going to get to that. But he realized that companies were wasting the information that they gathered about customers and sales. MicroStrategy quickly became a premier data mining firm extracting intelligence, a favorite Saylorism, from swamps of undifferentiated data. MicroStrategy famously helped Victoria's Secret discover that women in New York buy more black bras and that Midwestern women buy larger bras, causing Victoria's Secret to change how it stocked their stores.
Well, if you have 100,000 items and you have 1,000 stores, you have 100 million combinations of inventory, buckets of inventory, every day. And it's likely that, you know, you find people go and there's not enough in one bucket and there's too much in another bucket. And if you have the wrong inventory mix, you lose a lot of money on merchandising. Up until about 1995, the traditional approach of merchandising was I have exactly the same assortment of items in every store, the same types of lingerie, the same sizes of lingerie.
Whereas the people in New York may want different things than the people in California, than the people in North Carolina, than the people in Texas. And the reason that you were of value to them is that you determined from the data they already had in their company databases that this was the reality of their sales patterns.
You could think about what we create is a large information refinery.
And so, you know, what's so interesting hearing him say this is, this sounds so obvious now. I mean, this is like the primary way that the internet was monetized 10 to 15 years later, when free social media websites, Facebook, would gather all of our data and then sell it to companies. Saylor was saying back in the 90s, it occurred to me, this is kind of stupid, he says, jabbing at his salad as if he's trying to kill off old business practices. Why try to guess what the consumer is going to buy next year? Why not just ask them? Ask the customer. So you get the system like Blockbuster and you say, what is your favorite movie star? What is your favorite actor? Who is your favorite director? What is your favorite type of movie? What type of movies would you like to buy when they first come out? Who's your favorite musician? And so on. And by the way, that's interesting that he says Blockbuster. I mean, now that's exactly what Netflix does. They show you what you want to watch because they know what you want to watch based on your preferences. I have, by the way, a whole set of Titleist golf balls, and this must be, I don't know, from the 90s. And it has on one side of the ball the MicroStrategy logo, and on the other side of the ball the Blockbuster logo. And if anyone knows where these came from, please let me know. I'd be curious to know what event there was that was sponsored by MicroStrategy and Blockbuster. So interesting. Blockbuster, once upon a time, this great brand that didn't make it, superseded by Netflix. But even today, MicroStrategy is still around, albeit in a different iteration.
I'll give you an example which impinges upon government policy and the consumer, and illustrates, I think, pretty well how intelligence technology is going to change the world. And that example would be the traffic system. In Northern Virginia, we have about $250 billion in a traffic machine. Right. And that machine is used 800 million hours a year, and 280 million hours of it are congestion. Which means if you do the math, it only works 65% of the time. 35% of the time, it's clogged. Now, you can solve the problem of traffic in two ways. One way is the 20th century way, which is I pay $30 billion to build more highways, and I make everybody mad because I'm ripping up the road, and it takes me 10 years, and at the end of the 10 years, the traffic system is 10% better. Or the other way is I can collect a catalog of 5 million people's traffic demand. Where do they want to drive?
Change patterns.
And I can look at how fast the traffic is moving.
Yeah.
And if I have a road like Route 66 and it's about to clog, I can pick the 15,000 people in Northern Virginia at their desk about to get on that road, send them a message to their pager or their telephone and say, you know, you might want to take a different road because this one's open, that one's clogged. Or everything's clogged. Sit where you are, surf the web, talk to your mother on the phone or have a cup of coffee because you ain't going nowhere. Now, the truism with traffic is if I can move you from 105% utilization to 95% utilization, the rate of speed on the road goes from 5 miles an hour to 60 miles an hour. You debottleneck the entire system, you free up the congestion, and that network starts to work more efficiently. Now, here's the punchline. Instead of spending $30 billion to improve the effectiveness 10% in 10 years, you could spend $100 million and improve the effectiveness by 10 or 20% this year, now, and get all the benefits and do it for 1/100th the amount of money.
So here he's talking obviously about traffic, which is another theme that comes up from time to time in these early Michael Saylor interviews. And I wanted to share this because, you know, it's almost like he's describing sort of like an alternative universe that we could be living in. You could totally imagine this sort of technology available to us, but it just never really happened. And I think it's a good example of how good ideas don't always happen. So just because it's a good idea, just because that we have the technology, doesn't mean it's going to happen. I mean, today traffic is still a problem. We have overbuilt on infrastructure that we can't afford here in 2024, and it doesn't seem like technology has fixed that yet. Maybe because it was a government partnership that he was trying to accomplish. I don't know what the answer is, but I think it's interesting to listen to something that just didn't quite hit the mark. At least as far as I know, it doesn't seem like this, that MicroStrategy has solved this problem yet in 2024. I also want to mention that I know that there are some people, there are some Debbie Downers that will talk about how, you know, Saylor, when he's doing this sort of big, kind of big idea vision casting, some might say he sounds a little unhinged, and I get that, and you know, you should always be skeptical. Everyone is a scammer. I think it's probably, you know, he's done this so much that it's just clearly who he is. The guy is, he's brilliant. You know, sometimes he's right, sometimes he's wrong. He's probably more often right directionally than not. And I enjoy it personally. I think a lot of financial people criticize him for making grand claims. I kind of like the idea that there is a financial person that is himself and is okay with like speaking like a human being or speaking like a someone that you know, enjoys science fiction, enjoys the Isaac Asimov Have Spacesuit Will Travel book. So I like it. I think, you know, it's good to be skeptical. You know, like don't take everything Saylor says as financial advice. But I enjoy that about Saylor. Just recognize that some of the things he says, as boldly as he says, it might not pan out the way that he would envision.
And then you free up 200 million hours of time every year to go and invest or read or be with your kids or live a better life. And so I think that this is a revolutionary point in time because people are used to spending a lot of government money on concrete and steel. They don't really think about spending government money on intelligent networks. You know, we have a bridge in D.C. called the Wilson Bridge.
Right, I know it.
Okay, it's a $1.3 billion project to replace that bridge, and $500 million is just to make it a 12-lane bridge instead of a 10-lane bridge. And you know, they only need the extra lane for $500 million because 15 minutes a day, people are not smart enough to get off the bridge. And so if they could debottleneck that bridge with intelligence, right, they could afford to buy everybody a cell phone in the entire state.
So credit where it's due. One of the things that visionary Saylor was so right about in the 90s was URLs. He recognized that there was going to be digital scarcity on the internet in the form of like .com URLs. So Saylor was one of the very first to recognize the digital scarcity of literally acquiring the names of URLs. So I think he's bought tons of them, still owns them to this day. He owns, hope.com, which is now a Bitcoin website. Strategy.com is the MicroStrategy website, and Saylor owns Michael.com, which is his personal website. And I think famously a few years back, I recall him selling voice.com, the word voice, voice.com, for $30 million. So, you know, if you're looking for like proto Bitcoiner Saylor intuition, that was definitely there with recognizing the digital scarcity of these .com domains, which today was very hard to find good .com domain names rather. And, you know, I would just say, like, with these visionaries, it's, you know, you can't have it both ways, right? You can't have someone that is a grand visionary that isn't also maybe a little bit crazy. sounds a little bit mad at times. There's that Seneca quote, it's, there's no great genius without a tincture of madness. And I think the way that you sort of can vet this out is just by paying attention to what he's been doing over the years. I think we have a long enough track record with Saylor to recognize there's something worth paying attention to here. Now, in the vein of a proto-Bitcoiner sentiment, there's a really interesting section of this Charlie Rose interview from 2000 that I'll play for you here next, where Saylor is talking about trust and he's talking about the banking systems. And what he's saying is basically he's responding to the critique, which now we know is a very valid critique, that perhaps I don't want some technology company to have all of my data. Perhaps I don't want to trust them with my medical data. Perhaps I don't want to trust a company to run the traffic on software. And what Saylor is making the case for here is that you need to have trust with these companies, and these companies need to prove themselves as worthy of trust. And he makes the point that the banking system, if it doesn't have trust, you can't have an economy if you can't have a banking system that is trustworthy, which is super interesting today, because now we're trying to talk about a banking system that where trust is minimized, and so we're not emphasizing today the need to have trustworthy institutions. We're talking more today about developing technologies which are trustless or which minimize the need for trust.
Trust is the core issue. You have to trust this deposit of information. And I would say that trust is central to the development of our entire Western civilization for the past 2,000 years. Now, if we roll the clock back, I would offer as a metaphor the bank. What is a bank? A bank stores information that people have about their personal wealth holdings. In order for a bank to work, we need to trust the banking system. And the way we do it is the government defines a currency. I can sell my pig, and you can sell your land, and she can sell her seed corn for money into a market. I get the money back and I have to trust the currency, because if I sell my pig for, you know, $10 and I got to buy it back for $100 next week, I'm not going to trust the markets. That's why inflation kills the banking system. If I do have a government that has a stable currency, then I can trade all my assets for money. Money is information. I can put the money into a bank, and the banker is a database guy holding a ledger of everybody's name and their money and protecting their interest. Now along comes a guy that has a lot more time than he has money. He wants to start a farm. So he borrows money, flips a note back, takes the money, buys land, gets pigs, gets some seed corn, plants, creates the farm, sells that stuff in the open market, pays off the interest of the bank. The banker passes back that interest to the depositor. Everybody with assets gets interest. Everybody without assets gets a loan.
So another thing that I find interesting about the argument that Saylor is making here, and I don't know if I agree with it or not, I just find it fascinating to consider, is he is correlating this skepticism of these ideas of you know, trusting these sorts of technologies with sort of an anti-technology bias. So there's a quote where he says the perverse observation here is your anti-technology tendencies are exactly what the establishment wants, because every financial provider is taking advantage of you. Every medical provider is taking advantage of you. Every standard vendor is taking advantage of you in the current status quo. So he's talking about disrupting the current status quo. What we're talking about here is an intermediary that's a union. that's just as powerful as they are, that's as smart as they are, that fights the information war with them all the time. And if you trust me primarily rather than them, that's really the war. So some of this has panned out, right? Like I would say in some ways, conventional mainstream media being disrupted by podcasts and Twitter is probably for the better. But in other ways, it's been a lot of winner take all, where there's a lot of power in some of the hands of these large platforms. So I think it's so interesting. I don't know what the answer is. There's an anti-technology bias at play, but also we've sort of seen some of the results of this for better or for worse.
Trust. We are not born with an instinct to trust. Must be earned. Trust must be proven. We earn it with integrity. We prove it with sound advice. Trust is the ultimate measure of our success. And at Dean Witter, we measure success one investor at a time.
In 1996, Saylor will be named Washington's high-tech entrepreneur of the year. And then in 1998, is going to be the IPO, the initial public offering for MicroStrategy, which is going to make Saylor a billionaire at a young age. He was quoted around this time saying he rarely thinks about getting rich. I thought this was pretty good. He said the first few million is important. You can buy a nice house. The rest gives you credibility to approach people to ask them for things. When you're worth a certain amount, you get the attention of everyone in the room. He plans to be running MicroStrategy for 30 years. He has refused buyout offers. He said the largest was for $100 million. And he said if someone were to offer him $10 billion, he would still refuse. I have an ethical obligation to the people who work for me. So I think that quote actually must have been before the IPO, since he did become a billionaire at the IPO. But the foreshadowing there, Saylor stepped down within the last couple of years as CEO of MicroStrategy. So if we were to do the math, I would say he was CEO for at least 30 years. You know, in some sense, he still controls the company, but he's no longer CEO. He's the chairman and founder of MicroStrategy. But that's pretty unbelievable for a guy like that to control a company like that for as long as he did. You know, you don't see that very often. In fact, now it's sort of the exact opposite. Those that come up through like the venture capital path are often very focused on exiting the company. You know, sometimes you'll see like the cringe thing on LinkedIn where someone will say like they're like a 3x founder or 5x founder or something like that, which I always think is a little bit of a red flag. You want to be the guy like Saylor or Bezos, where they found a company, it works out, and then they are able to keep the kingdom. They're able to keep the keys to the kingdom, if you will. So I don't know. That's just my personal preference.
Hello, Kathy. Stock alerts.
MicroStrategy software is creating a new generation of one-to-one e-business.
Where's that idiot stockbroker? No, I don't want his voicemail.
E-business solutions through web, wireless, and voice.
Oh, nothing. Just another merger.
MicroStrategy, the power of intelligent e-business.
So here we are in January of 2000, and what you just heard was the MicroStrategy Super Bowl commercial for that year, which sort of symbolizes peak MicroStrategy. I think they spent like $8 million on that commercial. And this is going to be sort of the beginning of the downfall. So you had the IPA in 1998, you had the IPO in 1998. And I think the stock price between 1998 and the peak in 2000 is going to 10X in that period of time. But here's what I want to get into to the extent that I can, is this accounting fraud, which is going to be the sort of the scandal that rocks MicroStrategy, that rocks Michael Saylor, kind of takes him down a peg from sort of like a darling of the 1990s to someone that has some questions in his background now at this point. And it's, you know, it's kind of hard, like looking around, it's kind of hard to find the real story of this. But I did find a good piece that seems pretty fair-minded by an expert named Cass PNC, who wrote a piece on Medium called MicroStrategy Before Bitcoin. And I'm going to share with you some of this piece, because I thought that it did a pretty good job. But it says, you know, the beginning of the end of the internet bubble is sponsored by a slew of auditing firms that aren't just being criminally negligent, but often committing outright fraud. These firms go from being known as the big eight to what's today known as the big four. So everyone remembers Enron, WorldCom, that was Arthur Andersen at the time. But MicroStrategy is going to engage with PricewaterhouseCoopers, PwC, who of course is still around today. And so in March of 2000, what happened is MicroStrategy is forced to restate its accounting numbers for 1998 and 1999. So that's huge. They're forced to go back and restate their numbers. The stock, which went from $6 to $333, is now sent back to earth, and it falls 91% in about a month. And so here's what happened. If you're a lawyer or have a keen interest in securities law, I don't, by the way, you can read the SEC complaint. If not, here is kind of the cliff notes. So what the SEC is going to allege here is that MicroStrategy, through a series of shady accounting practices — that's not my words, that's what's here in this blog post — made their books look better than they were in reality. So some of these practices were leaving the date blank on contracts so they could be effectively signed right before the end of the quarter to beat earnings, recognizing revenue from unsigned contracts, again, to beat end of quarter earnings estimates, counting sales for service as sales for software, and then recognizing barter transactions. So for example, trading $5 million in software for $5 million in hardware as sales. So here was the end result. There was a settlement. So Saylor, his co-founder, Sanjeev Bansal, and then Mark Lynch, they neither will proclaim guilt nor innocence. They are going to pay some fines, and MicroStrategy is going to pay a large fine as well. Without getting into all the details, the defendants are also ordered to cease from ever engaging in any activity like this again and are more closely monitored for an extended period of time. But maybe the larger story, or the more important piece to this, is that the role of the auditor is going to play an even bigger role here. So this is before Enron, this is before WorldCom, but this is still sort of part of this kind of era of accounting scandal. Who's going to end up paying an even larger fine is PwC. They're going to pay a $51 million settlement, which was much larger than the fines paid by MicroStrategy and Saylor. And it will later be discovered that the auditing firms giving the thumbs up to pretty much everyone is playing a huge role in the financial bubble. And so, quick aside here, you've got the auditing firms that are playing a role in this financial bubble. Another thing that is often downplayed in these discussions of really every financial bubble, but of course the dot-com boom, is monetary policy. I mean, it's just never talked about. I think this was the Greenspan era, who was playing a role in sort of loosening up monetary policy. You know, today, for shorthand, we just call that debt binging or printing money, if you will. I mean, that's not very nuanced, but you get the point. Sort of easing up monetary policy does help lead to these monetary bubbles, these financial bubbles. And the shame of it is there are often some good ideas in things like technology booms. The dot-com boom had some good ideas that come out of it, but oftentimes, because they're parts of a bubble, they're smeared in the media, they're smeared in financial markets, and a lot of times, you know, you don't make a joke about the pets.com, but there are some good ideas that come out of it, and it gets soured by these financial bubbles, which oftentimes are exacerbated or even initiated by like government monetary policy or central bank monetary policy. Okay, to get back into it, MicroStrategy and Saylor clearly take advantage of auditing games between 1998 and 2000. This is this piece here. The extent of it becomes clear in a New York Times article that says two things. So number one, a very troubling bit in the last side of New York Times article is that a large portion of the fine was paid to the SEC in MicroStrategy stock, While individuals bring up the auto bailout of 2008 as an example of the government investing in public listed equities, that is a very different example. In one example, companies that the government believed in and hadn't committed any crimes were given taxpayer money in the hope they would succeed. In the case of MicroStrategy, a company accused of fraud is paying government fines with company shares. Paying off SEC fines in company shares feels like a conflict of interest on every level. This is from this article. And then secondly, he says, and this is, again, this is this author commenting on the New York Times finding, most companies that face fraud charges and a subsequent massive downturn in stock price attempt to alter their board of directors and definitely remove the executives accused of the fraudulent acts. In this case, perhaps because ultimately Saylor is the number one shareholder, neither of these events took place. Saylor is going to be able to keep his throne, and major advantage of him controlling the company is he didn't step down and he didn't have to step down. So the article goes on to sort of make its conclusions. And he says, it's fair to make the assessment that these fraud charges are from two decades ago. And since then, MicroStrategy and Michael Saylor haven't been accused of anything nefarious. Additionally, considering the company hasn't gone bankrupt and the stock price hasn't gone to zero, it's probably fair to say that MicroStrategy, while fudging the numbers between 1998 and 2000, wasn't a straight-ahead scam. The fact that Michael Saylor, the co-founder, CEO, and primary shareholder, is making reckless decisions with the company funds, be they good or bad, isn't likely illegal and doesn't need to be commented on to examine what's happened before. And by the way, so Saylor, during this period of time, Saylor's comments, while he's never really going to come super public with what happened, at least as far as in any of the stuff that I can find, the comments that we do have sort of do line up with this idea that, you know, I don't think Saylor ever thought he was doing anything like morally wrong. Maybe he was being aggressive. Maybe he was sort of pushing the boundaries of the rules as he thought that they were. But, you know, in terms of putting like a moral implication onto this, I don't have enough intimate knowledge of this to be able to say that. And it sort of seems like, you know, he's kind of pushing the boundaries. Some of the quotes that you hear from Saylor at the time, he had said that he had been the victim of what he called bean counter sophistry from PwC, the auditor, and from the jackals in the press. And for a while, he was refusing to apologize on the record, although he did end up making a formal apology, which I think was good, sort of saved the stock price for a period of time. The 35-year-old Saylor, who owns 56% of the company, has seen $10 billion. Two-thirds of his paper fortune disappeared since the stock price peaked 2 weeks ago. This is obviously written in 2000. You would be fazed at losing $6 billion in a single morning. You would fret if your company were pilloried for dubious accounting practices. But Tyro billionaire Saylor seems utterly unaffected and largely uninterested. He insisted that his company did nothing wrong and he moved on. I signed up to change the world, Saylor likes to say. He compares himself to Thomas Edison, Henry Ford, Andrew Carnegie, and John D. Rockefeller. When you are changing the world, who cares about a few billion dollars here or there? Even Saylor admits he's a zealot. He sees the edge, but he likes it. The way we've played this business and the way we have played the game at MicroStrategy is unwilling to hedge ever. Going to the limit with the idea that it's better just to risk it all the time than it is to play it safe. I am doing stuff right now that risks it all. Well, as we know, a couple decades later, he's going to risk the company yet again by adopting the Bitcoin strategy for MicroStrategy in, I guess, 2020. This is just who this guy is. He has no problems taking major risks. That's just in his DNA. I will say it does seem like the company was managed fairly conservatively for a couple decades after the dot-com bust. When they did adopt the strategy in 2020, I think their debt was pretty reasonable. If they had any at all, they had a lot of cash on the balance sheet, which is why they adopted the strategy in the first place. They had all this cash and Saylor basically needed something to do with it. And he was skeptical, from my understanding, of doing acquisitions. which is the playbook. That's what you're supposed to do. If you're a big tech company, you do acquisitions. That's going to keep you relevant. That's going to keep you growing, which is going to make Wall Street happy. But it doesn't always work out. And a lot of times failed acquisitions are the demise of some of these companies. And so I think it's interesting that although he risked the company, he also might have given us a playbook of how we can sort of do growth reasonably, how we can make growth sustainable. He isn't trying to force the issue. He's saying, hey, we're going to put our treasure in Bitcoin. We like that asset. We think it's going to do well, as opposed to roll the dice on some acquisition that may or may not work out. So as we wrap up here, I'm going to share a few of my takeaways from the sort of early Michael Saylor story. You know, the one thing that I think he's told us about this period that still rings true today is he's still here. I mean, he's still himself. He's still the same guy. He's seems to have the respect of his employees, shareholders, and the regulators. He's had skin in the game at every step of the way. One of the things I recall reading about this period was there was like a $125 million line of credit or something like that, that one of the banks had floated to the company that they were going to pull during this time when they're having financial problems. And Saylor personally guaranteed the line of credit himself, which is basically unheard of at the time. But he's had skin in the game at every step of the way. And so there's this quote by Thomas Sowell, and Sowell says, it's hard to imagine a more stupid or more dangerous way of making decisions than by putting those decisions in the hands of people who pay no price for being wrong. Saylor has personally paid for every decision that he's made, as far as I can tell. There is a wealth manager that I respect, the guy by the name of Anthony Deedon. He has a company called Edelweiss Holdings. I have a highlight from one of the Edelweiss journals that said, quote, while there are risks that we cannot afford to take, there are also risks we cannot afford not to take. Principal among them is that of deploying our savings alongside like-minded business owners and managers of an enduring endeavor. Like-mindedness is that state where one shares certain characteristics, motivation, incentives, and time preference. Among such traits is the right owner's ability to adapt to change. His customer orientation, his sense of identity, and strong corporate cohesion. We also share similar views as to being stewards. It's the end of the quote from the Edelweiss Holding Journal. And I think it captures sort of the best of what we can say about Saylor here. So I mentioned earlier, you know, at the time of most of what I'm talking about here in this podcast, you know, Saylor, I think, was probably seen as one of the great, you know, potential next great American CEOs. And I think you'd have to say that, you know, at this point, you know, the transition of MicroStrategy from a company that had the promise of Apple, Amazon, or Facebook, or Oracle is both a retreat, but also a home run swing. I mean, who knows? I mean, maybe MicroStrategy basically becoming, you know, arguably the best Bitcoin ETF for that period of time before the ETFs were proven. And who knows, maybe even still today, some might argue, is going to mean that they're going to have a second act and an ability to sort of realize that promise. I remember when they first deployed the strategy, I my initial impression from just reading the headline, well, cynically, was like, oh, this is just, you know, gimmick by a publicly traded company that's trying to sort of jump on a trend and use the headline to their advantage. Now I think I see the wisdom in it. I mean, as I just said, like, why do acquisitions like every other tech company only to put your company at risk, potentially decrease shareholder value? So in a sense, Saylor has transitioned from, you know, a true entrepreneur to maybe more of a financial engineer, although he's always been sort of a financial guy, it seems like, again, by sort of basically being the best Bitcoin ETF when the SEC was not approving Bitcoin ETFs. He's also issuing new shares to buy Bitcoin. So that's a little bit of a financial engineering going on there too. And then, of course, just buying debt to buy Bitcoin. That's, again, that's the speculative attack. At the same time, like, financial engineering is the way the game is played today. So this is the world that he's playing in, and you know, he's doing it well, and he's doing it on his own terms. So, you know, it is what it is in that regard. Also, I think I should point out that Saylor has established now the Saylor Academy, which is a nonprofit organization that provides free online university, and this seems to be largely his vision of his legacy. We've talked about generational family wealth before on this podcast. Saylor University seems to be, you know, kind of his vision, or at least his public vision for what generational family wealth looks like for him. And basically, it's a free university level education that presumably is funded for centuries by this billionaire. And so perhaps there is a way for him to realize his promise yet as a visionary. Time will tell. That is the visionary of the Bitcoin future. We shall see. That will do it for me. Hope you enjoyed this episode. Me sort of sharing some notes and some various thoughts about young Michael Saylor. I'm going to share most of the sources that I used for this podcast in the show notes. So make sure you look for that. You know, if you want to shoot me a note, I'm sure I got a bunch of things wrong. Send me an email, andy@simplewealthkc.com. Baby number 4 is due for us any day, so it might be a minute before I get the next podcast out. But I hope you enjoyed this. That's it for me. Thanks for listening.